Alex. Thank you so much for talking with me today.
Of course. I'm excited. Thanks for having me on.
It's great. Oh, cool. Yes. I just want to tell you that I really liked this movie. I've been able to watch it. I thought it was a good old time. And I think it is a great start to this Epix Blumhouse 8-picture thing that they've got going on.
Nice.
Do you feel any pressure having this be the first movie that everyone's going to see?
I was excited. I was actually super excited to be the first one because, like, there's nothing to compare it to, really. So if people love it, that's awesome. And if they don't, they can't be like, oh, the other five were so much better because they haven't seen it yet. So I was actually really thrilled to break the ice with this whole thing.
I love it. How did this whole deal come about for you? Did they ask you to write this or did you pitch it to them?
I wrote the script last year. It happened really quickly. I wrote the script last year during the lockdown pandemic stuff in LA. And then my agents and manager were like sort of sending it out and they just sent it out. And like a day or so later, Blumhouse came back and was like, we really love this. We have this deal with Epix. We want to make this. And I was like, this is incredible. Like, when did things ever happen this quickly? Never. Like, my previous movie took like 5 years to get it to happen. So I was like, this is great. And so instantly, and then it happened really, really quickly. And then they were like, okay, well, we'd love you to start shooting. Like, and it was like, you know, a date that was like 2 months in the future. I was like, oh, wow, this is like wild. And so I was within a few weeks of the call, I was like on an airplane in New Orleans. And so it was really, really great. Rapid fire.
Incredible.
Yeah. It's super unusual. And I've never been involved in anything that happened that quickly and went so smoothly. I mean, everything with them is, you know, they're obviously very skilled at what they do. So everything was like went like clockwork, which is awesome. That was the story of how it happened. I was as surprised as anyone else.
That's so awesome. Yeah. Like you said, nothing like that ever happens this quickly in Hollywood.
I've never written something. And then, I mean, so it was basically written and shot and completed within roughly a year, which is usually it takes a long time, you know, send stuff out and get notes and there's a whole process. So it's good not to have to do that this time.
Where did the inspiration for this story come from? As we're all in lockdown, inspiration strikes randomly.
Oh, right. Yeah. Well, I was like, it was funny. Like I always wanted to do something about sort of a relationship falling apart. You know, I mean, I've been in relationships and been cheated on, and I was watching some of my friends go through weird stuff because suddenly people were in lockdown, they're working from home and they're in LA, you know, maybe they just have like a one bedroom apartment or there's, suddenly they're compressed together and any flaws in the relationship or cracks start to show and expand. And so, and at the same time, I was thinking like, yeah, maybe this troubled couple goes off to try to reconnect as a family and someone shows up who's going to call them on all their stuff. And I've always been fascinated by the archetypes of like child preachers. I grew up in Texas and there are indeed weird things like that in the air. And so I was like, yeah, what if the person who shows up views themselves as some kind of moral force who's going to test them and see who's good, who's righteous, and who isn't, and is going to dispense some kind of awful justice in a demented way. And so that's what all kind of came together. And then from there, the cast kind of elevated it, you know, to something beyond what was on the page.
Did you know that everyone was perfect for the role, especially because it was so quick? You don't have a ton of time, but enough time to find the perfect people. What was casting like?
Yeah. It was really interesting. Like Paul Schneider was my first and only choice for the guy. I loved him. I lived in North Carolina for a long time. He's from there. So we had a lot of mutual friends. I knew of him. He's the perfect, like he can play the perfect kind of blandly appealing, like average dude. Who masks some horrible dark secret. And so I thought he'd be great. And I love him in this movie, Bright Star, this Jane Campion movie, where he plays an interesting complex and complex character with good side and a dark side. So he loved the script. He was on board like instantly, which is great. And then Angela I knew from Westworld, but I didn't know she would be as amazing. She actually read for it and her audition was like, just blew everyone away. And I was like, we have to get her. She's incredible. And then with Jacob and Leah, who are just two up and coming actors, it's so much fun. I mean, they're both incredible. Leah is now, you know, doing her Marvel thing with the Eternals.
She killed it in your movie, and she killed it in that one.
I know, absolutely. She's so good. She's like a force of nature, and so is Jacob. I mean, Jacob was in things when he was younger, like Mud and The Maze Runner, and is now, I hope this paves the way for him to get some really juicy villainous roles, because he's really compelling. I think he's amazing.
He's so good. I found him terrifying in the best way. Yeah. Because he's like that calming presence. And I feel like if you didn't have the right person, this movie wouldn't work. Because you can have a family. Oh, yeah. They can sell that. But you have to find Jacob. You have to find the Isaac, you know?
Absolutely. And that's a great point. I felt that way, too. And shooting on the bayou, too, and having a character who's Southern. It's also, you know, a lot of people who read for that role were trying to do like a Southern accent. And it's a hard one to do. So it's tough. But I mean, Jacob lives in Arkansas, was born there, and he knows the South like the back of his hand, and he's like understood, you know, the challenges of that role, and added some authenticity to it. But yeah, absolutely. I think with a horror movie, a great villain or antagonist is always super crucial. So yeah. he could be that charming. He's kind of a charming but devilish.
Right, he's the charming creeper.
Totally the charming creeper. It's so true.
Like, that's what I'm going to call him from now on. So I'm taking over the charming creeper forever and always. How did you find this house? Because I was speaking with Angela and Leah yesterday, and they mentioned like the house was also a character, which I fully agree with. And you found this incredible home on the bayou in Louisiana. Like, how did you even
find it? Well, we had a great location scout who's taking me to see different properties. And there are a lot of cool homes on the bayou, but I was looking for something really grand and huge. And so finally he told me, he was like, well, I know there's this one place way, way out in Slidell in like the depths of the bayou. And I was like, oh, let's go. So we like drove out there. And because it's COVID, we had to take separate cars, and I kept getting lost in the bayou. we finally arrived, and it was amazing. It's like, this family has owned the house for a couple hundred years. Everything in it is like antique, vintage, super expensive. And they were definitely interesting people for sure. They were very nervous about letting a film crew into their lives. But they did. We were there and they let us use their stuff. We had to be careful not to break anything. And the house is so amazing. It's like on the bayou with all the moss and the trees and the kudzu and the water. And the water level would rise and fall like sometimes by like 10 feet. So some days the house would have this huge back lawn, and other days the water would be like halfway up it. And that the bridge in the movie was covered by water at one point. Completely. So bizarre. And to them, it was totally normal. But to me, especially with filming, to come every day and find that the landscape is slightly different was an adjustment.
Yeah. It might look cool for the film, but for the like.
Oh, yeah. But the house totally became a character. I mean, we were inside there. We shot a week of nights in the house, and it was really, really great. I mean, I'm a night owl, so I love it. What probably wasn't great for everybody, but for me, it was so much fun. I love being up late at night. And so we shot like through the night, and it was so cool to be on the bayou, all the sounds of the animals and the insects. We had a critter wrangler who would walk around and make sure that there were no gators or like that.
Oh, yeah.
But yeah, so it was just so much fun. We lit up the house with all these like, big floodlights, and yeah, it was really cool. That's the house cool. Is so cool. I love the house. I mean, it's creepy, but it's cool.
Yeah, I grew up in Florida, and like,
oh, yeah, so you
like know. I understand water and rain and gators and
you get, yeah, it's very similar. Yeah, you totally get it, because yeah, this was had the exact same from what I've seen in Florida. I haven't been there a ton. It has that same feel. Okay. When it comes to that.
You don't need to.
Yeah, stay away.
It's totally fine.
I'm going there soon.
Like, I left for a reason. did you shoot this over 3 weeks?
It was like, I think we shot it over, we had 21 days of filming, but kind of like, so yeah, like kind of like, but spread out, you know, and so it was like, we were there, I was there for about, like a month or 6 weeks for pre-production, and then filming was about a month or a little more. And I mean, like those filming days spread out. And then we filmed in the house was, I think, 16 days of the shoot was just like in the house. And then we built part of the house inside an abandoned mall because the owners wouldn't let us hang any lights on the ceiling, and they wouldn't let us have any blood or gore in the house. I mean, beyond a tiny amount.
Yeah.
Because they were worried it would get out of hand and ruin their, like, you know, $1 million rug.
I get it. Yeah. You can't replace that house has been around since like the early 1900s.
Oh, I know, right? It's like almost like filming in a historical site. So there was an abandoned mall that we got access to. So we had a great production designer, and he built a whole wing of the house that looks indistinguishable from the actual house. So we shot out the final days there, where some of the gorier moments happen.
That's incredible.
It was unusual, but it worked out really well. It kind of blended the magic of editing blends together nicely.
Now I feel like I have to go back and watch and see if I can figure it out.
Oh yeah, that's actually good. Yeah, it's hard. Like I think I managed to conceal it with certain camera moves, but it's probably possible. Someone was telling me that the Sofia Coppola movie, The Beguiled, which takes place in one house, was actually shot in three separate homes. And then it was just like, I don't know if it's true, but they're saying it was like three completely separate locations all just cut together to look like one giant house. I'm like, that's pretty cool.
That's super cool. I'm like, you did it with this.
I love any like camera magic like that. I love.
Do you think we will revisit this house on the bayou sometime in the future?
I hope so. I would love that. I feel like it's a whole world exists out in this house. I would love to go back there and film more stuff, like a prequel, sequel.
I know, like, I feel like Isaac and Grandpappy are not done.
No, I think their story continues. One of my favorite moments is near the end where they're in their truck heading Trundley. Not just pointing, but yes, their journey continues for sure. Even if it's never filmed, they're out there somewhere.
Like, they'll find a new house on a bayou.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. They're adept at finding different homes.
I love it. Will we be seeing any more future projects from you soon?
Well, hopefully, you know, after filming and editing this, I finished a couple scripts that hopefully I'm going to be shooting something next year about, also a horror movie, about two young bank robbers who get in over their head. It's funny. I actually haven't shown the script to Jacob yet, but definitely Jacob crosses my mind. Hoping to get that off the ground, and it'd be great to just keep the ball rolling and make more stuff.
Amazing. And I asked this to the girls yesterday, so I'm going to ask you as my final question: what is your favorite horror thriller movie?
Oh, I would probably go for absolute. Oh, I love probably Vertigo, or I mean, more thriller than horror. Vertigo and Blue Velvet. Recently, I really loved Midsommar and Jordan Peele's Us. I thought those are really good. But I'd probably go maybe a classic like Psycho. Maybe Psycho.
Love it.
Yeah, something like that. too many to choose from. John Carpenter's The Thing. That's another favorite.
Which is a classic, and you have to, like, if you've never seen it, I don't know what rock people live under.
I know, right? It's so amazing. It's so scary, and it holds up like so well. It looks better than most modern movies, and it was like made
for the practical effects. That's what I know.
The practical effect helps sell it. I tell you, it's true.
Awesome. Well, Alex, thank you so much, and everyone go watch A House on the Bayou.
Well, thank you so much. I really appreciate it.